Would you tell me your name and where you come from? And the question is, where is home for you?
After what 3 days, I know you from 3 or 4 days. My name is Bassel. No, Bassel Shehadeh. I'm from Syria. And what?
What means home for you?
What means home for me? Okay, it's a very dangerous question. Okay, because my answer could get you in trouble.
Just say it.
My home. I don't feel like I'm at all. Sometimes I feel it, but not all the time. It's complicated. It's enough.
Okay.
This film is about a dreamer who never stopped dreaming and gave everything in order to run after them.
Bassel was born in Damascus in 1984. He studied information technology in the University of Damascus and majoring in artificial intelligence. He graduated in 2006, and upon finishing his IT studies, he decided to redo his baccalaureate and apply to archaeology school, as he was fond of mining and had already volunteered for several excavations. Bassel earned his living by working for the Syrian National Museum and also worked in the IT department of United Nations Development Program. However, he was still trying to discover what he loved to do, and finally he found himself in photographing and filmmaking. Bassel was a talented musician. He wrote and composed several songs, and his instrument was the guitar. He won several musical awards, one of them in 2004, in Kids Song Competition, when he wrote a song called I Dream of My Home, and was performed by his 11 years old cousin. He also won another musical award when he was performing with his band, called Color, during the Francophonic Days Festival organized by the French Embassy in Damascus. Were about racism. Later on, he posted below his song in YouTube, "This is our first concert, our first song, our first band. Nothing could be more joyful again." Bassel was a traveler. He managed to travel all around Syria, hiking in the mountains for several years with his friends, and discovering different parts of Syria, its nature and historical sites. He managed to visit lots of places in Syria on his bicycle. When he embarked upon a bicycle trip around Syria, he didn't tell so many details about his plan. He's just posted a picture on Facebook with him and Abdelmenaim, his bicycle's name, as he liked to call it. He also managed last year, in 2011, to go on a motorcycle trip from Damascus to New Delhi in India. He passed through Syria, Turkey, Iran, Pakistan, all the way to India. He also had a name for his motorcycle, which was Lenin, and he spent about 2 months doing this trip. Carrying Aid to Camps is a documentary prepared by Bassel in 2010 during the drought wave that hit the northeast of the country. A number of people were affected and moved to stay in camps in the south. Bassel and a group of other young people carried food and toys to the kids in these camps.
Thank you. violente femme. Bonjour Grace Kelly, bonjour madame. Hello Superman, bonjour solitaire. Bonjour tous les jours, tout à l'envers.
Takes place in a restaurant in the old city of Damascus. It captures a group of Syrians discussing a new book by Khaled Khalifa.
Thank you.
My favorite film by Bassel is Saturday Morning Gift, though Bassel calls it his first bad film. It is based on a true story. He interviewed a kid while who lost his family in Lebanon War 2006. And this film was a part of Bassel's application for his scholarship at university.
شو بحب العطلة؟ بتفيق إمتى ما بدك؟ أحلى شيء هو التخت. أحلى شيء كان لما ماما تفيقني. فيق حبيبي فيق.
فيق حبيبي فيق.
يلا قوم. أخواتك فاقوا.
أخواتك فاقوا.
أنا حبيبي حبيبي إلي يا عصفورة بيضة
والموسيقى
أمي كانت فيني الموسيقى
لا يعتب حدا يزعل حدا
تعرف كنا كتير مبسوطين كنت أحلم وفي وأحلم
ماما في ينفد
تعرف شو أنا بكره العطلة
Bassel received a scholarship to study in the US but he returned to Syria during the revolution to help to train the activists by teaching them how to use cameras, how to make documentaries and reports about the revolution. He participated in the intellectuals' protest in the Midan neighborhood in Damascus and was detained. He was also part of the Freedom Money Project where the activists printed the 1,500 Syrian pounds notes, which on the one side looked as usual money, but on the other side had a leaflet that called people to protest. The activists were distributing these notes in the streets of Damascus and Aleppo.
لا يسمع صوت العمل المدني السلمي المعارض في سوريا أمام هدير المدافع وأزيز الرصاص، لكن مجموعة من الشباب ما زالت تؤمن بإمكانية إسقاط النظام من خلال النشاط المدني السلمي.
كل العالم عم تقول إنه شو عم تشتغلوا هلأ بوسط المعارك اللي عم تصير والانشقاقات وأعداد الشهداء، إنه العمل السلمي المدني ما له مكان هلأ بوسط هالفوضى وهالعنف. نحن بالنسبة لنا هذا اللي بلشنا فيه، وهذا من الآمن إنه هو اللي حيقدر يكمل للأخير.
منشورات ورقية تدعو للعصيان المدني لإسقاط النظام السوري طبعها ناشطون على أوراق العملة السورية، تم رميها في شوارع عدة مدن منها دمشق وحلب، فأحد لن يتردد بالتقاط ورقة نقدية عن الأرض مواليا كان أم معارضا.
العمل السلمي المدني هو اللي بلش الثورة، وعلى الأغلب هو اللي رح يحملها كمان بعدين. نحن عم نحاول نأسس مجتمع وحركة تقدر توقف بوجه أي استبداد وأي طاغية.
الناشطون استلهموا الفكرة من مجموعة من الشباب اللبنانيين عملوا على مشروع مماثل في مجال البيئة ورمي النفايات، رغم أن هذا النشاط من الممكن أن يعرضهم في سوريا لعقوبات قاسية تتعلق بتزوير العملة، مدة السجن فيها قد تصل إلى 15 عاما، كما أن عقوبة توزيع المنشورات قد تصل إلى 7 سنوات. استخدام العملة السورية كخلفية لمنشورات العصيان المدني التي أطلق عليها عملة الحرية تحمل العديد من الرسائل، فقيمتها في هبوط مستمر يوما بعد يوم، والوضع الاقتصادي للسوريين لم يكن يوما بهذا السوء. ماريا شحادة، MBC.
شارك معنا في عصيان المدني ويتكن جزءا من عملية الحرية.
Singing to Freedom is a documentary that Bassel made while he was in the US. He interviewed several radicals like Chomsky and others to present their opinion about the Syrian revolution. He tried to reflect the rebels shouting as if they were singing to freedom.
I think the thing that really strikes me is that when I do get a chance to talk to activists around the world, a lot of times they're feeling pretty desperate, or they're feeling isolated, or they feel like their intuition was wrong all along, and they feel pretty hopeless. If your intuition is that nonviolent resistance works, you're right. You know, it actually does work. It's the most reliable source of change in the world according to our data, and it's not just the most reliable source of success, it's the most reliable source of being able to live in a society you want to live in after a conflict was already over.
Of our revolution for freedom and justice has passed. More than 4,500 people got killed by the Syrian regime, and tens of thousands got arrested and enforced and disappeared. We face one of the most brutal regimes in the region and the world, mostly with peaceful protests, songs of freedom, chanting for new Syria and the new future, discovering for the first time within decades our voices and personalities. And how does it feel to bring down walls of fear as we stand for our beliefs?
Thank you. it has been nonviolence, I think, is preferred by any serious person. You only resort to violence as a last resort. But I don't presume to tell Syrians what they ought to do. They have to work that out for themselves.
Christian culture, they resent us. There's enormous amounts of hatred that goes back in history because of resentment.
Yes, there's hatred against us. Why? As long as we are supporting harsh, brutal governments, blocking democracy and development, because of our interest in controlling the oil resources of the region, there will be a campaign of hatred against us.
Is likely to be extremely destructive. Violent means generally, typically, place into power those who have used them successfully and will continue to use them, often very brutally.
We found some really impressive results about the record of nonviolent resistance, which is that it's over twice as effective in achieving both the ouster of a dictator or territorial changes than violent insurgency.
My name is Erica Chenoweth. I'm an author and a scholar of civil resistance. I'm in solidarity with the Syrian people. I reject the brutality and killing that the Syrian authorities are committing against the unarmed Syrian people. And because silence is participation in this crime, I declare my participation in the resistance through the Syrian sit-in on YouTube.
There are three major differences in societies that have experienced nonviolent resistance compared with those that have experienced violent resistance. In countries where there's been nonviolent resistance, they're much more likely to emerge from the conflict democratic. They're much more likely to emerge with a lower probability of relapsing into a civil war. And they're also much more likely to experience fewer civilian casualties during the conflict itself. As an example, in Syria today, the UN reports that officially 3,500 civilians have been killed in the course of the conflict. And this is a very large and disturbing figure, but it's nothing compared with the 40,000 plus that were killed in just 3 weeks of shelling of the city of Hama back in 1982, and the 200,000 people who had to flee the city for their lives.
To speak of a bottom line, The bottom line is the government has no legitimacy. We're living in the 21st century, and you have no right to hold power merely by virtue of the fact that you're the son of the person who held power before you. That's just completely unacceptable. And you can't treat a country and its people as your playpen. These are human beings. They are entitled to the same rights and the same dignities as everybody else in humankind.
Go ahead.
Hi. During your speech, you made a lot of references to Jewish people, as well as certain people in your audience, not Jewish people in general, but certain people, especially in your audience, to Nazis. Now, that is extremely offensive.
I don't like and I don't respect the crocodile tears. The crocodile tears.
The Jews did not take arms against the Germans.
My late father was in Auschwitz concentration camp. My late mother was in Majdanek concentration camp. Every single member of my family on both sides was exterminated. Both of my parents were in the Warsaw Ghetto Uprising. And it's precisely and exactly because of the lessons my parents taught me and my two siblings that I will not be silent when Israel commits its crimes against the Palestinians. And I consider nothing more despicable than to use their suffering and their martyrdom to try to justify the torture, the brutalization, the demolition of homes that Israel daily commits against the Palestinians. So I refuse any longer to be intimidated or browbeaten by the tears. If you had any heart in you, you would be crying for the Palestinians, not for the Latino.
I have long passed seeing the virtues of violence. I used to see some virtue in it. Some rightness in it, some inevitability in it, but I can't see the virtue. No. It's a cliche, but it's true. It's very corrupting. And I'll be honest with you, I found it very difficult to disagree with Nasrallah at the beginning, because I respect him very much and I respect the Hezbollah very much. On the other hand, there comes a point where you have to sort of stop with the politics, set them aside, and just look at what's happening with a kind of depoliticized eye and just use a moral judgment. And the moral judgment is, you can't support what's going on in Bahrain, and support what's going on in Tunisia, and support what's going on in Egypt, and suddenly have a reserve an opinion on what's going on in Syria. And so Ms. Fallon made a historic misjudgment, which I don't think he will be able now to extricate himself from, if for no other reason that most Syrians now loathe him, even though a year ago they deeply respected him.
سوريا بدها حرية ولما نحقق نارتنا سمونا ارهابية سوريا بدها
حرية
سوريا بدها
حرية
ولما حقنا ردنا سمونا سلامية سوريا بدها
حرية
سوريا بدها
حرية
That repression, the killing by the Syrian government of its own people, that is not an answer to conflict in the 21st century. That's why journalism is so important, why reporters must be there, and why citizen journalists on the ground, whether with their cell phone, with a little video camera, with a little photograph, why it's so important to get word out, because that links people all over.
This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, the War and Peace Report. As we turn now to Syria, the government crackdown on protesters in Syria has reached a new level of violence just as prayers ended Monday, the first day of the Muslim holy month of Ramadan. At least six people were killed earlier today, pushing the toll to at least 150 over the last 2 days. An attack on the central city of Hama began on Sunday when more than 100 people were killed by government forces, continued into Monday with another 24 dead across the country. Syria has banned most foreign journalists, making it hard to verify exactly what's happening there. I have just gotten someone on the phone within Syria, and it's very difficult to do this. So we want to go right to Razan Zaituna, who is a lawyer, a human rights activist in Damascus, who's been reporting on the recent protests.
The Syrian government knows what it's doing when it says no to reporters, because it knows that the brutality that will be reflected in those pictures, those images that get out, is what's going to undermine them. It undermines injustice. It undermines lack of democracy. It exposes the truth. The reason the Syrian government has banned the journalists is because it knows no army is more powerful than a single camera showing the injustice of that image, armed men against defenseless people.
انخيل وجاسم والكورة الحورانية
يا وطننا ويا غالي
الشام يا بخت الشام والمراجي الخلدية
يا وطننا ويا غالي
وسباع يا باب سباع والمراجي الخلدية
يا وطننا ويا غالي
رستم تلبيس وبياضة مقابر للبعثية
يا وطننا ويا غالي
طرطوس منبع ناموس ويا محلاها اللدئية
يا وطننا ويا غالي
يا ربي حما حامية أهل الفدا نشمية
يا وطننا ويا غالي
والشعبة كلها في ناموس صح رجال الحامية
يا وطننا ويا غالي
So if I were a Syrian activist, there are a few different mistakes that I could make. The first is thinking that I need to succeed right away or the movement is over. So I see a lot of activists sometimes thinking that because we've been at this for a couple of months and we feel like we're in a kind of a stalemate situation, we need to escalate our tactics to violence in order to win. And I don't know that that's necessarily going to help the movement to do that. In fact, with some research I've done with Kurt Schock, we find that having an armed wing doesn't actually help movements and can actually reduce the level of participation that the movements have already built up. So that can be a dangerous mistake. So impatience and thinking that arms is going to accelerate the process, those are two major mistakes. Another mistake is feeding into the disunity that might already exist in a society or sort of falling into the trap of allowing the regime to keep the civilian population separated from itself.
يا محلاها الحرية
لا ننخاف ولا نخضع
the repression and the heroism in Syria, the remarkable bravery of people. There are those who have died, thousands of people, but how people are surviving now and how difficult, how impossible it seems. In the end, people working together in movements always prevails.
At this moment, you know, the expression in English, you strike while the iron is hot. There's an opportunity came out of thin air. There's now this opportunity to free the Arab Muslim world from this dead weight that they've had to bear for nearly a century now. And opportunities in politics come and go. You miss them, and you may have to wait a very long time before it happens again.
من الله على الجنة جنة 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 والله يا وطننا جنة 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 والله يا وطننا يا وطن يا حبيب يا ابو تراب الطيب حد غازي يا خيب يا ابو تراب الطيب حتى نار الجنة حتى نار الجنة ابو عبد الله سرحان رمز كل الشجعان رمز كل الشجعان تتهنى بالجنان تتهنى بالجنان يا شيخ تتهنى جنة 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 والله يا وطننا جنة 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 والله يا وطننا جنة 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 والله يا وطننا
جنة 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 والله يا وطننا
يا ابو تراب الطيب يا وطن يا حبيب يا ابو تراب الطيب.
As I say, sitting nice and peacefully here, I don't presume to tell people what they should do when they're faced with murderous military forces, but the courage of the resistance has been very impressive and inspiring, and difficult as it may be, I think a pursuit of a nonviolent approach will be the best method of bringing in proper international support and indeed undermining the forces of violence themselves.
So if I were Bashar al-Assad, I would adopt a divide and rule strategy for the campaign. I would say, let me do two things here. The first thing I'm going to do is make them use violence against my security forces so that the security forces don't hesitate to kill. So I'm going to try to provoke them into taking up arms against me. The second thing that I'm going to do is try to sow divisions within the different groups in my society that I already know have tensions. So I'm going to try to make it impossible for the Alawites, the Christians, the Sunni Muslims, and the other people in this country to come together and unity. So I'm going to try to stoke tensions between them and make sure that they're divided. And I'm going to try to terrorize people. And the reason I'm going to try to terrorize them is because I know that I cannot repress them. I can't do it forever. So I'm going to try to use terror to just scare them so that they don't come out of their houses and join this revolution. So even Adolf Hitler knew, as we now know from his writings, that no dictator can rule by force alone, that they have to have a psychological power over the people, and they do that by scaring the living daylights out of them. So I'm going to do some really nasty things, and I'm going to do it really publicly, and I'm going to make sure that people know that I'm willing to do these horrible things to people to stay in power so that they won't continue to rise up against me. So that's essentially my strategy, and so far it's not working, but maybe it will the more I apply pressure.
Joining us from Damascus is a Syrian activist and filmmaker named Bassel. He just returned from Homs. For security reasons, he asked we only use his first name. Bassel, why don't we begin with you on the ground in Damascus where protests are taking place, and you've just come out of Homs. Can you tell us what happened there?
Hey, good morning, Amy. I just got back from Homs yesterday after spending 1 week there. The heavy bombing and shelling of the city continued for several days till the night of the Arab League delegation's arrival. I witnessed tanks withdrawal from Homs the morning before the observers arrived. The problem is, now I'm calling you from Al Midan area in Damascus. Activist has called for a protest in this area. And they expected the delegations, the monitors, to come and see the protest, but no one arrived here, and the security forces are cracking down the protesters. I can hear them running in the streets now, and they are besieged the protesters in one of the mosques here in the area. So we are wondering now why the delegation is here. They are cracking down on the protesters now, and we are wondering what are they doing here now.
And when you say bombing and shelling, you're saying that the Air Force was dropping bombs on the town as well as shelling it?
Missiles, like it's not a air bombing, but you can hear and see the bombing in the area. It's not like Air Force's one.
And in terms of the delegation, is the delegation traveling in one group from one town to another, or are they spread out so that some remain in Damascus while other parts of the delegation go out to different parts of the country?
Yeah, supposedly they have to stay in each city. Like there is a group in Homs now and another group supposed to go to Hama today. So, and yesterday there were clashes in Hama, and actually I can hear the security forces outside of the room I'm in now. So I'm like keeping my voice a little bit low. They're outside, Juan, so I need to keep my voice a little bit low. Sorry for that.
We can hear you just fine, Bassel, but we want you to be very careful. You can tell us you can't talk. That is fine. We also have a guest here in the studio, Karim Nishar. Yeah. But I do want to ask you about who is killing who in Homs, in Hama, in Damascus right now. Tell us who the forces are.
Actually, the violence in the city of Homs is like what I saw the last week I was there, like it's threatening to turn into like almost a civil war. A heavy crackdown on the city, punishing the rising area and killing the civilians, is forcing the locals to form like an armed resistance to the regime's forces, and they are supported by army deserters. So the fights is between the locals and the security forces and the supporters of the regime. The rising areas are besieged by the regime forces. I tried to cross to the besieged area of Baba Amr for 3 days, but I failed to enter this area. I witnessed, and actually I was shot by snipers when I was trying to cross to these areas. people are forced to fight back, to block out the security forces and make their way out to provide food and supplies. So like they're putting the people in the position like they have to defend themselves. This is what I saw in Homs. But the violence is raising and the tension is like becoming more high there.
And Bassel, when you say snipers, are these snipers Syrian forces, or are they people in civilian garb? Is there any ethnic battling that's broken out as well?
The snipers are for the army, actually. And I'm sure for it. And I was shot while trying to cross from area to area. I was like, they tried to shoot on all of the people trying to cross. And they are army forces.
Can you describe what you're hearing right now, Bassel? Again, we don't want you to endanger yourself. Stop talking if you have to, if you must leave. Tell us.
I'm trying not to, like, the activists with me in the house, like, told me, like, I have to keep my voice a little bit low because they hear, like, a lot of troubles outside. Actually, the security forces are cracking against the protesters outside now.
Have you had trouble with security forces yourself before?
Yeah, I was arrested for a while.
And you were detained.
Yeah.
Karim Nishar.
Actually, a lot of my friends are still detained. Yesterday, they released around 700 detainees, but still thousands of detainees are still in the prisons. Among them are tens of my friends. They are not terrorists. They are filmmakers, journalists, doctors, lawyers. They are very high intellectuals, people, and activists.
Can you talk about the reports of prisoners, like you were once, but prisoners now, being moved from the city of Homs as they brought in the Arab League monitors?
Actually, this is a Human Rights Watch report. This is the only thing I heard about it. But it was leaked from the army itself. Some officer from the army leaked it to the Human Rights Watch.
And what about defecting officers, of defecting soldiers?
They are increasing, and I met some of them in Homs. They are supporting the locals, fighting back and trying to defend themselves. But the violence is raising in this city, and it's really, really dangerous. Like, you cannot walk after 3 o'clock in the city, you will be shot, and you don't know from where it will come. From the army or from the locals? Like, it's like a total chaos there.
And how are the activists able to continue, like yourself and others, able to continue to organize and communicate to prepare either demonstrations or other opposition activities?
Actually, Juan, more than half of my friends in prison now, I have friends who've been killed. So a lot of them like flew out of the country now. They are based in Beirut or like somewhere outside of Syria, in Turkey also. So we are having a lot of troubles now. And
when you say killed, have they been killed in prison?
No, I have one of my friends have been killed while trying to cross the borders to Turkey. He's a doctor. And he was providing help for protesters, and they followed him, and he tried to cross the borders to Turkey, and they shot him on the border.
Bassel,
this is one of the cases.
You're incredibly brave to be in Syria right now as a filmmaker. What about the crackdown on the media? No Western reporters really able to in any way function openly there.
I heard of some journalists are being in Baba Amr now, or some there are some journalists succeed to sneak in to Homs and other areas. And actually, when I held my camera and went to Homs, I went and shot some during this week. I was holding a weapons with me. Like, if they discovered this camera in any way, I will be like in total dangers. So it's very dangerous to hold a camera and just travel around the country.
You are talking about the protests in Damascus and the Arab League monitors being in Hama. The history of Hama, where massacre took place in 1982 under Hafez al-Assad, the father of Bashar al-Assad, the significance of this area, and what people are calling on these Arab League monitors to do.
Actually, I witnessed in Homs that the security forces are confused how to handle the peaceful protest while being watched and monitored by the observers. Like videos, we witnessed some videos where the protests happened in front of military and security barriers. People were chanting and accompanied with the observers, by the observers. And the regime thugs forced not to crack down on them as they do usually. The problem with the size of the delegations, like there is a 20 persons only in Homs, 5 persons of the delegation in Hama, and the area they will cover. Like the security forces are confused with when they are presents, but they cannot cover all the areas in Damascus. The killing is like there is is continuing where there is no observers, but it stopped where the observers are there. So it's a very complicated thing. But people are very optimistic about this delegation. They are calling tomorrow for a Friday to crawl to the freedom squares. They want to start the sit-ins in squares in the cities, like Tahrir Square in Cairo. And they are very optimistic of this delegation. But what I saw today, there is no one came to the protest. So I'm afraid tomorrow, like, people will try to go to these squares and they will be shot. And it's very dangerous to try to go there. Last time in Homs, they went to the square, of the main square in Homs. They killed over 100 person there. So tomorrow they will try to go, and I don't know. It will be maybe a bloody day, or it will be a Tahrir Square day. We will wait tomorrow and see.
But the hope is that they will do the they will organize the protest while the observers are there to.
We are hoping the observers will come, but today no one came. So let's hope tomorrow. I don't know.
And the criticism of the Arab League monitors, headed by the Sudanese Lieutenant General Mustafa al-Dabi, who was once in Darfur, where a prosecutor, of course, from the International Criminal Court says the Sudanese army carried out war crimes.
Yeah.
His comment that he saw nothing frightening, he said in his initial tour of Homs.
That's right. But I remember, I still remember the night before they came, the bombing and the shelling to the cities was like, it's like crazy thing. They stopped as the delegations came. And this delegation will stay in Homs for only 1 month. This is the mission of the delegation. So the regime stopped bombing the Baba Amr area and all the rising areas.
Right. The mission is going to stay there for 1 month, the Arab League mission?
Yeah. Yeah, this is what's supposed to happen.
Well, but presumably, because there has been bombing and shelling, there will be evidence of it, unless the government has cleared away the
damage. And they saw it.
The damage.
They saw it. Yeah, but actually, the head of the delegation didn't went to the Baba Amr area. They went yesterday without him. So he made this comment without going to this area.
The debate over intervention, is there one? Do people look at Libya as a model or as a problem? Do they want to handle this themselves?
It's different from the capital to Homs. People in Homs are desperate there. I run with women and children to cross streets where snipers are like making fun, like shooting in the air. People there are desperate, and they need to have a solution. People in Damascus are a little bit like they are not witnessing what happened in Homs. So it's different opinions here and there, but surely we are all agree like we need some kind of protection, some kind of observers and journalism. We need press to come here and be free to move. This is the protection we need. And I think, like, just journalists come to Syria, like, and have free to move around the country, it will be a big protect for us.
Bassel, please be safe. A Syrian activist and filmmaker, he was jailed himself. He is speaking to us from Damascus. Security forces are right near where he is right now. Of course, we're going to continue to be in touch with you. And if you have anything you need to report now, just please talk to our producers. Okay. Very brave to share this report with us today, just out of Homs.
Bassel spent several months in Homs, and it is possible that there are several of his recordings still awaiting to be discovered. Freedom March is a video that has appeared recently online. It is uncertain who made it, but it shows Bassel recording a protest in Homs.
بينهم هلا وقت اللي عم نسب على النظام حقه يا اخي يا ويس، بس في اعداء بينه وبين كلمة حرية، شو القصة؟ إذا مصيح سلمية أو مصيح حرية لطيف. يعني لو إنه مسلح وعم قوس عليه ما كان قوس، إذا مصيح سلمية بده يقوس.
سلمية للأبد غصب عنك يا أسد.
الشباب صاروا معابينا عشان يقطعوا ليك وين هنيك.
يعني بدك تغامر هلا، بدك يعني توكل على الله وتمشي، ما في غير هيك، بدك تتشاهد وتمشي، وان شاء الله انه ما بصير معك شيء، ان شاء الله الله بيعمل قلبهم وما بيشوفوك، وان شاء الله بنقدر كمان نسحبك صار شيء.
قول يا رب، قول يا الله.
اشهد ان لا اله الا الله. نطلع سوا يعني؟
Thank you. يما مويل الهوى يما مويلي ضرب الخناجر ولا حكم الندل بيا ومشيت تحت الشتاء والشتاء رواني والصيف لما أتى ولع من نيراني بيضل عمر فدا مهر للحرية يما مويل الهوى يما مويلية ضرب الخناجر ولا حكم الندل بيا شهيدنا البطل أغلى من العالي مفتاح درب الأمل والأمل برجالي يا شعبنا ويا بطل أفديك بعيناي يما مويل الهوى يما مويلية ضرب الخناجر ولا حكم الندل بيا
كل يوم مننطر تيوقف صوت النار أمي تقول طلع وصار أمان اتسابق نفوت لبرا الدار بين الأسلاك بين الحيطان بدنا نلعب ولو دقيقة بعد شوي صوت القصف بيرجع قالوا فينا نبقى أكتر يا ليل وبسرعة صوت أمي منسمع يا ولاد ارجعوا عالبيت تتسلينا بتحكي قصص هالعتيقة تحكي عن بيت عبر عشقفة أرض والأرض فينا نرجع اه لو بعرف
بدموعك يمي نعيش ما فينا نرجع آه لو بعرف طريقك يا وطني آه لو بعرف طريقك يا وطني
Bassel's close friends also quoted him saying Just imagine how many times are we going to witness a revolution in our lives? How could I leave this dream that's about to come true? What am I going to say to my kids when they would ask me about it? Should I tell them that when the revolution started, I left my homeland behind and went to build my future career? What this future could be without a freedom?
كل يوم مننطر تيوقف صوت النار أمي تقول طلع وصار أمان يتسابق نفوت لبرا الدار بين الأسلاك بين الحيطان بدنا نلعب ولو دقيقة بعد شوي صوت القصف بيقف